Just as an FYI, if you want to continue to think about some of the things that I've spoken about and to move in the direction of things that were being discussed, this is my book. It's available out there in the narthex. If you don't have enough money, just take one. I'm serious. If it's like you can't afford it, just take it. If you need it, you know. If you think it would be helpful and you just don't have the money, by all means, you know. Have one. But it's just something as an offering, you know. It's not the definitive guide. It's just something that helps us. I think we're just talking. We need to continue to make the paradigm shift between this world and the next world, between that which is temporal and that which is eternal. And anything we can do to help us in that process ultimately is something we need to try to embrace. And so they are for sale out there. There's $15. And it does have the prayer rule in it, believe it or not. The prayer rule is in the back. It's all spelled out for you. So, what's that? I do. There is a chapter on prayer. And the chapter on prayer is called Prayer as Communion. It's really important for us to embrace that perspective of prayer as communion. Remember what we were talking about earlier? What is the classic textbook definition of prayer? Prayer is... three words.
Converse and union.
Thank you to the man in the front. He's obviously closer to me. See, he's proximity helps. Right? Prayer is converse and union with God. And so understanding prayer as communion is very effective for us to be able to embrace this whole paradigm shift that we really need to make from the rule to the relationship. Right? From the rule to the relationship, so that I just don't pull up to church or to my icon corner and do the rule so I can put the check in the box, right? But ultimately, I find the real content of my life through that relationship, just like I would find the real content of my life through the relationship of having a spouse, like marriage or a family or a good friend. It's the same concept in the sense of God as person. We find true fulfillment in that relationship that we have with God, and it's not just like Jesus is my friend. It's something that's so much more deeper. He actualizes our personhood. That union brings about our true fulfillment as a person. In the same way that we travel from the image of God, which is just a given, being made in God's image, right? That's our gift. We travel from there to the likeness of God, right? Which is something that we do by our own effort. We have to do a lot. We process things. There's a process there that's moving us towards God and towards the things of God, keeping the commandments, fasting, prayer, all those things that actualize the likeness of God in us. In the same way, without God, we're not really persons. Person is just still potential. Person always means communion, and ultimately it means communion with the person, which is God. When I talk about person, all I am is just an individual right now without God. I'm just an individual. I actualize my personhood through my communion with God. And ultimately, because God is person, and because God even is in through the incarnation, human, man, right? I also actualize that personhood through my relationship with you. You know, and that's why it's so important. We think it's sometimes just by the way, like, I can treat you poorly and say that I love God. It does not work. If I can't see God in you, I'm never going to see him. If I say I love God and I hate my neighbor, I'm a liar, St. John the theologian says. Why? Because Jesus Christ was a man. If I treat you like garbage, how am I going to treat him any better? You know? And so that's why it's really important. It's our challenge, because sometimes we don't always feel like treating people well. And the reality is that God doesn't give us the great commandment to like everyone. What does God ask us to do? He asks us to love everyone, not like. God doesn't say like your enemies, like your neighbor, right? He says, love your neighbor, which is a radically different concept. Love is a choice. Love is something I do. It's not something that ultimately I have to feel, and if I feel it, oftentimes more often is, as we know, like if you're a parent, it's painful. Love hurts, right? The wayward child, the difficult child, the back talk, the struggle there in families, right? Love is painful. And it's no different as we look at our neighbor and the people that are around us, whether in the church or at our workplace or whatever, we have to make a conscious decision with God's help to love them. Say, Lord, bless them anyways. Lord, help them, save them, and have mercy on us all. We're all struggling. So that's really important. But let's get back, because I could just go on and on about other things, but I want to give you the prayer rule first, okay? And the prayer rule is really important because there's three basic rules to prayer that kind of preface the whole thing. Very important preamble is that we need to involve the body in prayer. Holy God, holy mighty, holy immortal, have mercy upon us. It's not for without reason that the church asks us to do this, right? To make the sign of the cross and to make it well, you know, not to be too sloppy or kind of slack as we do it, but rather to make it our prayer, our worshipful prayer with our body, right? As we thank God for all things, right? We involve the body. And involving the body is an extremely important part of what it means to pray, because when I pray with my whole person, I have to pray with my body. And that's why a lot of the times the churches, remember, like during Lent, we say, O Lord and Master of my life, take from me the spirit of sloth, despair, lust for power, and idle talk. And we go all the way down to the ground. We're involving the body. Right? Give rather the spirit of chastity, humility, patience, and love to thy servant. All the way down to the ground. This is what the church asks us to do. Every Lent, and in the monastery, I feel like we're doing it like thousands of times, like throughout the course of Lent, because, you know, there's like three Santa from prayer, three prostrations, then the 12 bows, and then one more prostration, and it happens like at least maybe like, I haven't really counted it, maybe like 10 times in the morning and at least 5 or 6 or 7 times during the evening, that set of 4. So I feel like we're just constantly doing it. But again, the point is not just vain repetition, which is always bad in prayer, but the point is that this does help us. This does orient our heart in a certain direction. Why? Because wherever the body's going, where do you think the heart's going to go? It's on the floor right now. And now it's coming back up. And my physical heart really is, it coheres in the spiritual heart. The physical heart and the spiritual heart, they cohere in each other. And so when I pray with my heart to God, it's actually physical and spiritual. And when I pray with my heart and I say, O Lord and Master of my life, right, my heart is participating. Why? Because it's down on the floor right now. Do you know what I'm saying? The heart is a part of that whole process, and it's exceptionally important for us to involve the body in prayer. One of these, the modern Orthodox commentators on prayer, they said that we don't try to escape the body. Rather, we go in prayer, we go deeper into the body. Why? Because the kingdom of heaven is where? Outside or inside? It's within. It's within. We're not going to find it out there. It's very important to realize, where is it that we need to go? We need to find the heart, and we need to go into the heart. I think it's St. Isaac says, if you go in the heart, he says, you'll find the rungs by which to ascend the ladder to heaven. You know, it's inside. So it's important for us to involve the body. And so normally, I think, you know, if you could just, the reason why I call it 10-minute spirituality is because it takes 10 minutes basically to do this prayer rule. It can be expanded into a very large prayer rule that takes a lot longer, but this is kind of the bare minimum. I think that 10 minutes gives us an opportunity to not be too intimidated by prayer. So I could do 10 minutes. Everybody can, in your mind, that sounds reasonable, right? I say, can you pray for 10 minutes? And you're like, yeah, I could try, right? Doesn't sound too bad. And if we give ourselves this kind of perspective on prayer, it makes it much easier to keep climbing these steps. if I just take, you know, a lot of times, like, let's say, like, I've had a difficult night or something like that. We've been had to do things, or there was a problem or whatever. I'll just take 10-minute little spurts during the day to try to regather myself and my spiritual perspective. I won't take, like, long periods during the day, if especially when I don't have them. I'll steal 10 minutes here. I'll steal 10 minutes there. I'll steal 10 minutes over there. I might run into the chapel, you know, I disappear for a minute, and they say, where did he go? And I'm, you know, in the chapel, nobody noticed, 10 minutes. And then right after lunch, I'm walking by the church, and spontaneously, I'm going to go in church, I'll pray 10 minutes, in front of the icon here or wherever. And then I'm in my room, I say, oh, I'll just pray for 10 minutes. That spontaneity really helps when you're thinking about spiritual life. Just say, you get this good impulse to do something, just do it. Maybe I should pray right now. The moment that I start thinking about it is the moment I lose the opportunity. Well, maybe I should wait till later. Well, maybe all of that kind of deliberative process, the steam starts to evaporate, and all of a sudden I'm back kind of to square one, and the possibility for that encounter or that opportunity to do something spiritual will be gone. You know, if I don't act on those kinds of things pretty quickly, they dissipate rather quickly, unfortunately. So, if I can give myself 10 minutes, that's the minimum time, I think, and I think that the church gives us. You know, in the church, most often, especially at the monastery, and one of the church hours, you know how we have the first hour, the third hour, the sixth hour, the ninth hour, those are all, of course, corresponding to time periods, right? Third hour is at 9 o'clock, right? It's basically the old biblical time, right? The first hour is when? If 9 o'clock in the morning is the third hour, when's the first hour? 7, right? 7 a.m., right? Sixth hour is what? Noon, right? And then the ninth hour is what? 3 o'clock, right? Like Christ hung on the cross from the sixth hour to the ninth hour, it says. And at the ninth hour, he said, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. That was at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So the church gives us these church hours, but the reality is how long is a church hour if you do it relatively quickly at the monastery? It's about 10 minutes, maybe 15. But it's the basic kind of amount of time that we need to reset our clock, our internal clock that orients us from temporal things to eternal things, that gives us an opportunity to change our perspective. 10 minutes is the minimum time that it takes to decompress and to come back to myself. And ultimately, the quintessential movement of prayer is given to us by the prodigal son. The prodigal son journeys to a strange land, right? We read about it at every Lent. He journeys to the strange land, and he wastes all of his money in riotous living, and he wants to be fed even with the pods that the pigs are eating because he doesn't have anything. And then it says, and what does it say that he does before he is able to change? What is it that affects the change in him? In the scriptures it says, he came to himself. He came back to himself. He'd been going out, riotous living, doing all this over here, want to go to another city, want to do big things, I want to spend my inheritance, right? He's going out from himself. And this is the quintessential movement of the fall, to go out from one's own heart and to keep just going away from yourself. And anything that oftentimes the world will do, the most often it will be this movement away from myself, so that I'm over here and I'm thinking about the vacation, and I'm over here and I'm thinking about the car, and I'm over here and I'm thinking about you and what you did to me, and I'm thinking about this, and over here. I'm going constantly away from myself. And the fathers see this as the fall. What is the reversal of this fall? It's coming back to yourself to bring the attention, which really literally is called the noose. The noose is the eye of the soul. It's the eye of the heart. It's the center of our being. It's our attention. I bring my attention back to my own heart. And it's in that movement of coming back to myself, like the prodigal son. The prodigal son, when he comes back to his own heart, when he came to himself, he says, oh my gosh, what am I doing? My father's servants have enough to eat, and I don't even have anything. I will return to my father's house. That didn't happen, though, until he came back to his own center, to his own heart. And so really, when we dialogue with God, there's a twofold movement that takes place, and sometimes it's almost instantaneous. There's a movement back to myself, and then from my heart to God. If I speak to God from outside of my heart, oftentimes my prayer has no content, and it will very quickly just dissipate on the ground. Like, and I wonder, why, God, don't you hear my prayers? And the possible answer could be that we are speaking to God outside of our heart, outside of ourselves, in the sense of we're not really speaking to God. We're just probably continuing the monologue with ourselves, like the Pharisee in the temple. God, I thank you that I'm so great, and that I'm not like that guy over there. Right? That's the Pharisee. It said he went up to pray in the temple, and he basically just talked to himself. You know? And so prayer can't be like that. And ultimately, sure, we're going to be distracted in prayer, and sure, it's going to be hard, and sure, blah, blah, blah. But the 10-minute rule gives us a perspective that offers us something that's very palatable and very transformative if we are consistent. So the first real rule of prayer is to be consistent. Whatever you do, consistently do that every day, even at the same time. Every day at 6 a.m., I do this little rule. That is what I do. This consistency will be the success in the whole process. We must be deeply committed to the process. Whatever we do, we need to be consistent at it. The other rule is that we need to be flexible. Prayer is not some kind of dead static thing where we just go up and we just kind of do what we do and then we check the box and then we're done, right? There needs to be this dynamic sense of encounter in prayer, which is always willing to respond. Again, responding to that relationship with God rather than just kind of, again, fulfilling the rule. The third rule is to, start again. Start again. St. Theophon says, when we pray, we need to pray as if we've never prayed before. So that we don't rest our great gifts that God, we think that God owes us something because we've been doing so good now for so long, and that, you know, and then when things go bad, then we get mad at God because I've been praying all this time, Lord, and why did you let this happen? Right? We just pray as if we've never prayed before because then there's no expectation. And we meet that opportunity to encounter God in a way that is truly relational rather than static. You know, we come expecting to encounter God and for something maybe different this time or maybe something new. We don't approach it as if we know what's going on. We know how it's supposed to be. And, you know, la, 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 this is the way it always is and blah, 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 and this is what I do and now I'm done. Right? There's this opportunity for encounter when we start again. And the reality is that even if we haven't prayed for a long time, we need to just start again. So the rule always applies, whether we've been doing good or doing bad. We just start again. St. Paul says, forgetting what's behind and straining towards what's ahead, I press onward to the high calling in Christ Jesus. So there's this sense of just, if it's in the past, like, forget it. Like, we need to move on. Sure, there's things that have damaged us that we've done, sins and so forth. But that's what the beauty of repentance is. It's this sense of like, you know what? I can't change the past, but I can do something in the present. What will I do today that will mitigate or, you know, move me in a different direction so that I can continue to follow the Lord? We can get so bogged down with guilt and with shame and difficulty that we're just paralyzed like the man, the paralytic who needed four people to carry him to Jesus. There's a saying that I saw on Facebook, believe it or not. Something good on Facebook, yes. I saw one thing, and it said, if you're living in the past, if you're depressed, you're living in the past. If you're worried and anxious, you're living in the future. It says, if you're at peace, you're in the present. You know, and then, you know, can you imagine the little dash, and it says Facebook. It was somebody's quote on Facebook, you know. It wasn't actual, you know, Facebook didn't say it, but somebody on Facebook said it. But that's really helpful, though, for prayer, because it keeps that really good perspective, and also for repentance. It's like, I can't change the past, but I can certainly do something right now, because if I have this moment right now, this is the gift of repentance. This is the gift that offers me this gift of today, which is totally all potential. Sense of what am I doing right now to continue to go the right way towards the Lord, to follow the Lord, to respond to the Lord, and to do what I need to do. So anyway, so the prayer rule starts with a Trisagion. Everybody knows what a Trisagion is. If you don't know what it is, buy my book and find it on page 157. Right? It's just a standard beginning for any service in the Orthodox Church. So Trisagion, Holy God, Holy, O Heavenly King, etc. Right? It's the way we always start our prayers in the church. After the Trisagion, you could do Psalm 50 and the Creed. That's a very traditional monastic prayer rule. Trisagion, Psalm 50, the Creed. Why would you do Psalm 50? Well, it's the quintessential penitential prayer. It says the most important words, a broken and humbled heart, O God, thou wilt not despise. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence. Take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and with thy governing spirit establish me. Right? This is something that we need to say to God all the time. And it's the prayer that God will always hear, the prayer of the penitent. Why? Because that psalm is written by King David after his adulterous affair and after he killed somebody. Right, that's what Psalm 50 is. He committed adultery with Bathsheba, and then he killed her husband. And it shows us, though, that there's always hope. There's always hope. King David, the great saint, king, prophet David, right, committed murder and adultery, and yet he's still a saint in the church. He's still a great saint. But ultimately, he went through all of the difficulties, and he never let go of God. He brought to God that one thing that God will never refuse, which is our sense of, God, be merciful to me, the sinner. What was it that justified the publican and that alienated the Pharisee? The Pharisee, number one, he was monologuing all within himself. He said, blah, 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 I'm so great, and God, you should really pat me on the back. And the poor guy in the corner that was the publican, what did he say that justified him? God, be merciful to me, the sinner. Right? And God said, no problem. He was there like white on rice. You know, it was like, it was so close. It was like there was almost no time that elapses between a contrite prayer and the mercy of God coming to somebody who's offering it. It's almost like they almost fuse into one, because it is really the God who's the comforter. He is the one who brings us comfort. And if we're beseeching him for that kind of comfort that comes through repentance, he's so ready and willing to offer it. So Psalm 50 epitomizes that. Trisagion, Psalm 50, the Creed. And then, very importantly, I do five prostrations using the Jesus Prayer. Lord, Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon me. And I go all the way down to the ground, and I touch my forehead as close as I can. And if I can't do that, I do a bow. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon me. I touch my knee. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon me. Always use your knees as well. You know, when you go down, use your knees, because that'll help your back. I have a very bad back. But if I use my knees, that helps a lot. Even at the worst point where I can barely move, I can still do a prostration. It's a little bit slow, but, you know, it's always possible if we really want to. Why? Because it's our prayer, and it really helps us to pray. This involving the body right away is really important for being able to make some progress in prayer. It unifies our whole being, mind, body, and soul, and makes it so we can offer a prayer that is unified and whole to God. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon me. So I do five prostrations, right? And if I'm having problems with somebody, I do a prostration for them. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon my spouse who's troubling me or having difficulty. Or Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon my coworker who hates me. Right? I'm serious, because if I can pray for my enemies in that moment, that is the moment when God can fill me with his strength. Why? Because in obedience to the commandment, I'm doing something that's humanly impossible. God very quickly comes to the aid of those who step out into the abyss, hoping in God, right? In obedience to the commandment, I step over the cliff. And when I start praying for my enemies, there is this immense support and life that starts rushing into me because God asks us to do it, because only God can enable us to do it. And it is the one thing that shows that Christianity is not only real, but that ultimately God is, well, Jesus Christ is who he said he was, and only God would ask us to do that. Nobody, no other religion in the world asks you to love those who hate you. And why would God ask us to do that? Why? Because by thinking evil, we become evil. When we want vengeance on those who have wronged us, who is it that gets hurt? Who are we punishing with all that anger, with all that misery, with all of that kind of unhappiness inside? Who is being punished? Is that person being punished? No. They're probably rejoicing that they made us so mad, right? We're hurting ourselves. St. Theophon says that anger is the fire of hell, and it's never justified. Why? Because by being angry, who are we hurting? Hurting ourselves. The damage is sometimes irreparable. You know, we can do things when we're angry like mad people out of our mind. If we let it go, if we allow it to rain, we can lose it, you know? And it doesn't matter how much black we're wearing, in the sense of robes and crosses and stuff. Anybody, when they let anger reign, they can lose their mind very quickly and lose everything, you know? But anyway, so I pray for my enemies. Why? Because it helps me. And God bless them. It's interesting. Christianity, it's the only religion that asks us to pray for enemies. Why? Because in that moment that I do, in obedience to the commandment, it's God who fills me with his strength, and that is the beginning of participation in life in God on an existential level. It's a very concrete way that I begin to participate in the strength and life of God himself, because he has to do it. I can't. I'm just stepping out into the abyss, and I'm just with all my hope and trust in God. I just step out there, and I keep praying for those who hate me. Why? Because it ultimately is something that enables me to share in God's life. So I do a prostration for the people that are sick, the people that don't like me, and I make it real. You know, if I say I love my enemies, that means I pray for my enemies. And doing a prostration for somebody that really troubles us or really hates us is one of the most concrete ways that we can show that we're really trying to love those who hate us. And in that moment, we'll find God's blessing for certain. I know from a fact, because I have a lot of people that don't like me. So after, I try, but you know, you can't, what do they say? You know, you can't please most of the people most of the time. So I just, you know, do the best I can. But anyways, so after we do our prostrations, we stand in front of the icon or kneel, but don't sit, because sitting down is, you know, this is the nice way to pray like this, because you can keep your feet up a little bit, and it provides support. They do this in Romania a lot. It's a very comfortable position after you get used to it. You know, either on your knees or on standing in front of the icons, you say the Jesus prayer for 5 minutes out loud so that you can hear it. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon me. And you have a prayer rope that helps you, because, again, physical. There's a physical counterpart here. And I always have my 33 knot because it's just easier to use. But I have a physical thing that I'm doing to help involve my body in prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon me. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon me. And I'm just standing in front of the icon. And what am I doing? My heart is quiet. I'm trying not to engage my thoughts. I'm trying to engage this prayer. And ultimately, it's my tool to restart and to begin again that dialogue with God. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon me. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon my children. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon thy world. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon my grandmother who's sick. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon me, the sinner. Lord Jesus Christ, Son of God, have mercy upon us and help us in our time of need. Use it as the tool to dialogue. Say it so you can hear it, but that nobody else can hear it. Close your door. light the candle, stand in front of your icon corner. After 5 minutes, and it's better to have 5 minutes rather than to do a certain number, because we're Westerners and numbers really kind of start bogging us down. You know, they become almost intolerable lords over us, you know. And again, the rule prevails rather than the relationship. So I would recommend 5 minutes starting out. You know, you can do 10 prostrations in 10 minutes, but just start with 5 and 5. That's why I call it the 5 and 5 rule. Five prostrations, 5 minutes saying the Jesus prayer. After that, if you want to read any of your morning or evening prayers for just a couple, the ones that really mean the most to you, not many, just 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever, that would be where you would do them, and then you read a chapter from the gospel every day. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, over and over and over and over again until they become the sole law of your being. So that in every situation I have, the words of our Lord are my reference point. They're my foundation. They're my perspective on my situations. As life continues to go crazy, the gospel answers all the questions. And so oftentimes the people come to the monastery and they say, "What is God's will for me?" And I ask them, I say, "Have you read the Bible?" And they say, "No." And I say, "Well, start there and come back." Because it's so important to do the revealed will of God. If we don't do the revealed will of God, in the sense of if I don't love my neighbor and if I'm not, you know, doing all the things that basically Christ asks of me, how am I going to be able to do more when I haven't done what's lesser? How will I do the greater? And so we always need to start there. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, over and 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 over again. Did I make myself clear? Over and over and over and over and over again. It's not something like if you approach it with prayer. Because what it is that in the gospel, it's not just, St. Nikolai says, it's not a book, he says, it's a power. It's not a book, it's a power. Christ says to us, he says, "The words that I speak to you, they are what? They are spirit and they are life." They are incredibly transformative. It was St. Anthony who heard one verse from the Holy Gospel, St. Anthony the Great. He went to church one Sunday morning and he heard the gospel, "Sell what you have and come follow me." He left everything and he became St. Anthony the Great. And that, just that one verse he heard, and it just pierced right into his heart. Out in the desert he went for 50 years. It's not a book, it's a power. And it has the power to alter our entire existence. Why? Because St. Silouan says that behind every word there is a power. Stop! Don't do that. Hi. Right? All these different kinds of energy behind these words, right? He says, but behind the Holy Scriptures, he says, there's an uncreated power. There's an uncreated power. Behind the Holy Scriptures, St. Irenaeus says that Christ himself is the pearl of great price hidden in the field of the Scriptures. It's Christ. It's Christ. If you've never read the entire Bible before, from beginning to end, all the Holy Scriptures from Genesis to Revelation, I would highly recommend doing it. It's extremely transformative. And every line, St. Nikolai says, shows us a line in the face of Christ. The bigger our picture that we have of the Old and the New Testament, as we look at the totality and take a step back, we will see Jesus Christ clearly, not in like a frame, but etched in our heart. That likeness begins to become more real in us in some kind of unexplainable way as we continue to encounter him through the Scriptures. Somehow, something begins to be etched inside of us so that that likeness becomes more and more a reality. How does that happen? By responding to that word. So, Trisagion, Psalm 50, the Creed, 5 prostrations, 5 minutes saying the Jesus prayer. If you want any prayers, there they would go right after that, and then you read a chapter from the gospel every day. And if you want, after that, you can read a little section of spiritual reading, just like a paragraph or, you know, a page or whatever, but nothing more than that, just something very small. The point is this, is that when we do pray, it opens up the heart to be able to receive, and we are in a receptive state to approach the Word of God. And we'll find it to be extremely transformative and extremely life-giving. It has an extreme potential to change us and to speak to us. I can't tell you how many times It just blows my mind. I come into church, and the same reading in the church is the reading that I had this morning in my, you know, in my prayer time. How it happens, I have no idea. Even like during Holy Week, sometimes it happens. It's like, you know, like spot on. And I'm like, how does this happen? You know, this is impossible from the human level. Why? Because it's like I started like 20 years ago doing this, so you'd have to kind of measure, you know, each and every single day for the past 19 years to get to this point where this just would happen to coincide with the lectionary. You know what I mean? It's just, it's humanly impossible. But God, in that moment, he speaks to us, especially those special scriptures that we need sometimes so desperately to hear again and again and again, like, he who endures till the end will be saved, or in your patience possess ye your soul. So after we read the gospel, we say, it is truly meet to bless thee, O Theotokos, ever blessed and most pure, the Mother of our God. Glory to the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, now and ever, to ages of ages. Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy. Through the prayers of our holy fathers. Amen. Right? It's very simple. It's all on page 157. But the reality is this. It's the five and five rule. It's basically five prostrations, 5 minutes saying the Jesus prayer, read a chapter of the gospel. You have a beginning, you have an ending. That's basically what it gets down to. But it gives us an opportunity to be still. It gives us an opportunity to see who we really are. Because I'm not going to find it anywhere else. And the reality is I'm not going to be able to process my life except in prayer. I think that's why in our busy society, God has provided the great providence of the nursing home. Why? Because we're so busy doing so many things that we still need time to get ready. If we're kind of in that kind of go, 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 doing mode all of our life, if we die in that state, we're going to be in not a ready state to meet the Lord. Why? Because we need to process some things and allow some things to kind of percolate, to ferment. We need to kind of think about, okay, we need to pray. There needs to be some sense of stillness in us. I don't know if you've ever noticed this, but at the end of the day, sometimes I've been going, and then I finally get to my prayer corner, and it's like, I realize I forgot to put my laundry in the dryer. But it's only because I've stopped doing everything that all of that stuff kind of came percolating up, and it's like, and then I realize, oh, I can't believe I said that at the lecture at St. Matthew this morning. I shouldn't have said that. Oh, that lady, she really did need help, and I wasn't talking to her. All that stuff starts coming up. Do you know what I'm talking about? As you're going to bed or whatever like that. When we give ourselves that opportunity to process, it's invaluable. And it really is the self-care that is so necessary in our world that we tend to, like, we lament that nobody cares for us and that nobody is taking care of us and that nobody is helping us, when the reality is that we haven't been taking care of ourselves. And we might be crying and screaming inside because the reality is that we've forgotten to take care of ourselves in this particular way, in this spiritual way, which is so necessary, so vital, so important. It is the most important spiritual self-care that you can offer yourself, this kind of little tiny rule, which can expand, of course, but it's imperative necessity in the sense of the area of self-care, which, of course, you know, when you're in the mental health field or in therapy or whatever, you know what I'm talking about. It's just, we oftentimes don't take care of ourselves very well. And this is a way that we can do it spiritually that helps us to grow, that helps us to process, that ultimately helps us to reorient all of the garbage in our life and turn it into compost for our garden so that we can have beautiful flowers to offer people when they come by instead of them going, ooh, what's that smell over there? Oh, man, is that you? You know? It's like we needed to figure out how to do something with all that stuff because isn't our life like that? We get so much bad stuff. What do you do with it? Where does it go? How do you change it? You have to pray through it. We have to process it. We have to transfigure it. And ultimately, Orthodoxy has never been concerned about repression or dissolution or about rejection, right? Of all the bad stuff. What does it do with all the bad stuff? The anger, the lust, the pride, the greed, the vanity, all that stuff, it redirects it. It reorients it. It works to transfigure, to cleanse, and to restore. Isn't that what we do when we consecrate a church? It's called a restoration service. We don't only do that with ourselves, we do that with the entire world. Isn't that what an icon is? Isn't it the redemption of creation in a very, very concrete form? And this happens because of the incarnation. Because of the incarnation, this world becomes a vessel of grace. It becomes an opportunity for us to receive God's life, His grace, His power. What? Through this world. Why? Because of the incarnation. Because God filled it with Himself. And now all of that potential is just waiting for us to actualize, whether it's through iconography, through serving the services and having the Eucharist, through our life of prayer, through blessing our house, through blessing our car, constantly invoking the Holy Spirit on every difficult situation we get into. What is it? The liturgy shows us exactly what to do. What does the liturgy show us to do? We take this world, we put it on the altar, and then we offer it up to God in thanksgiving, and we call down the Holy Spirit upon it. And what does it become for us? A place where we meet God, where we encounter God for real, not in just kind of like, you know, like our theory and kind of, oh yeah, you know, you agree that it happens and I agree that it happens, so it must be happening, right? No. It's an objective reality that we participate in that's been going on for thousands of years. The liturgy shows us the pattern of how to do this. We take this world, we offer it up to God with thanksgiving, no matter what it is, because isn't that what St. Paul says? He says, and this is the will of God concerning you in Jesus Christ, that in everything you give thanks, for everything, good, bad, ugly, evil, offer to God and say thank you anyways. And in that moment, there's the possibility for redemption. There's the possibility for renewal. There's the possibility for the reorientation. Why? Because nothing in this world is innately evil in and of itself. From a theological standpoint, did you know that evil does not exist? It doesn't exist, St. Gregory of Nyssa says. It doesn't exist. It exists only, he says, in the will. In our will, in our free choice. We choose it. It comes into being. Isn't that amazing? Like, God gave us the ability to create even evil. God doesn't create evil. He created Adam and he created the world, and what did he say? Good. And then he created man and woman, he said, very good. Where was bad in there? Did you hear any bad in Genesis? Except maybe when man messed up and chose to do the wrong thing. He said, Adam, very bad. You've got to go outside now and think about this for few thousand years. There was nothing bad in God's good creation until Adam made the choice to bring it into existence, to choose it. This world is very good, and so the task of all of us is to recognize that it's that reorientation process that we go through, that our neighbor goes through, and even the stuff of this world needs to go through. And that's what the church is. The whole creation comes into the church, not just me and you and our souls, but our bodies and our worlds. Our cars, they drive through the door. Our houses, they come through the door. Our pets, our cows, they have prayers for everything. Everything is to be sanctified and to enter into the church. That's the great mystery of what it means ultimately of salvation, is that this world was created so that it could be united with God forever in a union without confusion, without division, and without separation. It's not dissolution when we're united with God, like in Hinduism, where the salt all dissolves into the ocean, right? We're not talking about that. Created still remains created. Uncreated still is uncreated. But they're joined together in a union that is forever. That's what salvation is. Our world being united with God. Body, soul, mind, and car. Everything. Do you understand what I'm saying? It's the world. I am part of this world. My body comes from this world. I just ate a bunch of shrimp from this world, and they became me. And you know what? If I make it think about St. John, right? St. John Maximovich. He's in San Francisco. He's under glass. He's incorrupt, right? Has anybody seen him? Yeah. Wonderful opportunity. If you've never seen him, I highly recommend looking up online St. John Maximovich pictures or going to visit the cathedral. But he's incorrupt. And this is a phenomenon that happens in the church. Why? Because they're so filled with God's grace, they're so filled with life that even death can't destroy them. And when we sing memory eternal, their memory really is eternal. Why? They're right there. You know, St. Joba Pachayev, they say he's still warm. The man is 500 years old. When we venerated St. Anna's foot on Mount Athos, it was still warm. Mary Magdalene's hand, still warm on Mount Athos. What is this a sign of? The sign that the resurrection is coming. That this world is destined for resurrection, not destruction. This world is destined for renewal, not destruction. That ultimately we're going to rise in this body and stand before God. Isn't it interesting that Job, in the book of Job, he says, I know this for a fact. He says, my Redeemer lives, he says, and in my flesh I shall see God. And there's a twofold meaning there. Jesus Christ, he's in my flesh, and I'm seeing God. And on the other side, I'm going to rise at the last day, and I will have to see God. In my body, in my flesh. That's the reality of not only our hope, but that's the truth. That's the truth.
I have a question. Did God know that Adam was going to fail?
That's a great question. She asked, did God know that Adam was going to fall away? And the answer to that question is yes. Because, of course, God foreknows everything, but his foreknowledge doesn't in any way take away our free choice. And the beautiful thing about it is this, is that the world, well, let's see here, what's the best way to say that? This. The incarnation was foreordained before the foundation of the world, St. Peter says. Christ was the Lamb foreordained to be slain before the foundation of the world. The incarnation, the crucifixion, and the resurrection were all not only foreknown, but even before the world began, they were slated for, you know, to be. This world, if you can believe it or not, in the sense of it's a big paradigm shift, but because God foreknew and that God planned the incarnation to happen anyways, because he wanted to unite the world to himself and the only way that it could be done was him actually doing it, this world was actually, it's a creation for the incarnation. Everything was created so that Jesus Christ could come into this world and take a body and save it forever. And that body will be united to Jesus Christ, one person, one body, one soul, forever in eternity. That is the immense value of our body, that even God himself will live in it forever. And that's why we don't cremate people. Why? Because it's the temple of the Holy Spirit. It's the dwelling place of God. Whoever destroys that temple, it says God will destroy him. So it's not wise to opt for cremation if you have a choice. I know if you're in Japan, you don't have a choice. There are certain instances where you don't have a choice. But if you have a choice, don't do it. Why? Because in the Old Testament, the worst thing you could do to somebody is to burn them after they had died. So that their memory would never be, they wouldn't be remembered ever. No remembrance, no proof, no evidence that they even were here. It was just gone. That was the worst thing you could do to somebody. But understanding that innate value of the body, that God came not only to save it, but to be united with it, it's like the dignity of what it means to be a human and what it means to have you and you and you and you. We can only begin to fathom and continue to grow in appreciation forever. You know, our neighbor is our life. That's what St. Silouan says. Our brother is our life. How I treat my neighbor is how I treat God. If I treat my neighbor bad, I'm treating God bad. Why? Christ himself said, Matthew 25, in that you did it to the least of these people who you thought were just nothing, you did it to me. And that's just mind-blowing. You know, it's something that challenges us all the time. Why? Because people are not always nice. We're not always well-disposed. There's always going to be challenges, but there's always repentance. There's always forgiveness. There's always a sense of like, gosh, I didn't do very good this time. How about next time? I can work on this. There's hope, you know? We're not perfect, but the reality is we're trying, you know? And we're going to keep trying until the very last day that we die. The good thing about it is this, is that in the Bible, you know, the scriptures, all those instances where God asks us to be perfect, he doesn't say be perfect like it's a finished process and say, okay, be perfect now. Hold that. Don't move. Nope, you moved. Sorry. He doesn't, there's no static quality in the Greek. It's a progressive kind of movement. Be ye perfected. Keep knocking, keep asking, keep seeking. It doesn't say in the Greek, it doesn't say knock and the door will be open. Seek and you find. It says keep knocking, keep asking, keep praying. It's this progressive process that it implies, which is not always given to us in English. And it provides kind of like for a very static kind of unfortunate model for us to try to live by. You know, I'm not perfect, so therefore I might as well not try. That's kind of what we feel like sometimes. But the reality is that's not what it's telling us to do. So the great mystery of prayer. St. John Climacus tells us about, you know, prayer is the greatest miracle that there is. And when I actualize or when I begin to have this consistent life of prayer in my life, it's in that moment that I can understand the true content of the liturgy, at least in some small measure. I can start entering more deeply into the liturgy, which is really the most valuable thing that we have in the entire world. Why? Because God gives his life to us. The more that I am receptive to that and open to that and prepared for that, to that same extent, I will receive. The more I'm ready to receive, the more I will receive. The more that the vessel of my heart is ready, the more that when they pour that grace in, it will actually stay there instead of leaking out all over the floor. Why? Because the vessel of my heart was damaged because of sin, because of criticism, because of any number of things. You know, prayer patches all of that up and makes us capable of being vessels for God. And fortunately, prayer, there's nothing that prayer can't do. You know, as a monastic, I can actually say that to you with all certainty and with all seriousness. There's nothing that prayer can't do. You need something? Pray. St. James says, you have not because you ask not. And so whenever there's some kind of difficulty, what do? We don't go to this world, but we go to God. St. John Climacus says, prayer, by reason of its action, upholds the world and brings about reconciliation with God. Reconciliation with God. It is the mother and daughter of tears, the propitiation of sins, the bridge over temptations, a wall against all afflictions, a crushing of conflicts, a work of angels, food for the bodiless powers, future gladness, unending activity, a source of all virtues, a mean of obtaining graces, invisible progress, food for the soul, enlightenment for the mind, and acts against despair, a demonstration of hope, a cure for sorrow, the wealth of monks, the treasure of hesychasts, the reduction of anger, the mirror of progress. Boy, it just keeps going. The disclosure of stature, an indication of one's true condition. Hint, right? We all need that. A revelation of future things, a sign of glory. And for him who truly prays, prayer is the court, the judgment hall, and the tribunal of the Lord before the second coming. Wow. Pretty impressive, huh? Everybody's just so excited to go pray, right? That'd be like the monks, like, you know, payday. You know, that would make me feel good. I did, though, encounter somebody at the parish that we were at last year or a year and a half ago or something, and gave a retreat there, and it was just so nice. I went back there with St. Anna a month or two ago, and this woman came up to me and she said, my life, you know, I've been doing what you told us to do, and my life is different. My life is better, and I can't thank you enough. I was just like, hallelujah. I was like, this actually, you know, like somebody, like, was paying attention, and somebody did what I said. It's like, it's so rare that actually happens. So I was sorry, Brother Max. I was just overjoyed that, you know, that she found it. You know, it's just some little, because, you know, it's the hardest thing to do in the world. This is not easy. I mean, it's easier to build skyscrapers than it is to have a consistent prayer roll. Did you know that? Much easier. They said that the modern world was built by monks who didn't want to pray. Basically, you know, because it's hard, you know. The last thing he says is, have all courage, and you will have God as your teacher in prayer. Just as it is impossible to learn by to see by word of mouth, because seeing depends on one's own natural sight, so it is impossible to learn the beauty of prayer from the teaching of another. Prayer has a teacher all of its own, God, who teaches man knowledge and gives prayer to him who prays and blesses the years of the just. Amen. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that beautiful? And that's why Christ says, one is your teacher, that's Christ, you know. He says, to call nobody on earth your teacher. Why? Because there's really only one teacher, you know. And ultimately, all teaching should point us to that. So, I have one question, though, before your question that somebody asked me during the break that they wanted me to address. And who was that? And what was it again? We were talking about, like, she was asking about how do you know, like, once you do start to pray, there is always the danger of delusion. Right. Well, yeah. Well, that's difficult. I think, though, that the main thing is that we're always willing to be corrected. There's this great story about, and I tell it probably too often, but there's the hesychast, the monk. He leaves, most of the time, monks, they leave after about 15, 20 years in the monastery, and they go out to the little skeets, you know, these little hermitages, and they pray. They pray deeply. And they find more, they go deeper inside their heart and find really the true wealth of the prayer, which is just inexhaustible, you know. When somebody strikes gold, it's like one of those things, you know, like you see the Texas oil things, you know, it just keeps flowing out, and it's like, you know, they're all excited because they struck oil, and it won't stop. That's what prayer is. When you really find it, like the monks, when they really find that prayer, it's this inexhaustible source of strength, blessing, grace, power. They become miracle workers, you know. Their prayers become so incredibly powerful and strong. But the monk, they goes out to pray in the skeet, the hermitage, and some of the fathers say, you know, he's kind of acting weird, and they think he's deluded, and they think, you know, he's got some, you know, some problems. And so the abbot goes out there, and he starts berating him and saying, you always were the worst of all the monks, and I can't believe you're out here, and you don't even know what you're doing, and what do you think you're doing here? You think you're accomplishing something great? He says, you need to get back to the monastery right now. And then the monk bows his head, and he says, okay. Doesn't say a word. And the abbot says, you can stay. You can stay. Why? Because that was the test. If he said, no, I'm praying. You don't understand. I'm a great man of prayer, and I pray every time, and I have all these hours, and I've been praying for hours and hours and hours, and I do all this stuff, blah, blah, blah. You know, like kind of the rule, right? You know, focusing on that sense of the rule. If you can't hear the word, then there's a problem. In the sense of if your priest says, maybe you're praying a little bit too much, or maybe you should try this, or maybe you try that. If we start kind of trying to justify ourselves in that moment, we know that there's a problem. We know that there's a problem. So we always need to be willing to take counsel. In our spiritual life, it's very, very important to always be able to hear and consider what people say. It doesn't mean that they're always right, but it does mean that I consider what you're telling me. And then I discern with other counsel and with prayer and with my own, spiritual life, I discern what I need to do. You know, because you're not under obedience to anybody. You know, God forbid that any of you at a parish would be under obedience to anybody. It's like, can you imagine that, Brother Max? I'm very undemanding of the monastics in the sense of we need to find our way. You know, and if somebody's kind of constraining you, like I don't constrain any of the monks at the monastery. I don't tell them that they absolutely have to do this, that, or the other. And if somebody is demanding that from you, it's not a healthy situation. Why? Because you're not a monk. And even if you were, that kind of obedience is not the norm. So beware. You're not going to anybody for them to basically run your life. You're going for counsel, and then you have to figure it out with more counsel and with more prayer and with more of that process that we need to be involved in. We need to find our way with a lot of help, with a lot of of what the church offers to us, but ultimately it's up to us. Why? Because the moment I put it on you, I'm going to blame you when something goes wrong. I can't tell you how many people have said to me, Father, what should I do? I was like, you do what you have to do. It's like, I can't tell you what you're going to do. Why? Because if I do, you're going to, if something goes wrong, you'll blame me. You'll have an excuse to basically take the responsibility from yourself. And ultimately, all of us are responsible for us. So taking counsel is very important in a life of prayer and in any aspect of spiritual life. Any aspect of life in general, we always need counsel. We always need to be supremely aware of the other. Sensitive. You know, isn't that kind of the height of clairvoyance? To be this so supremely aware of other people that we even sense what they're feeling and thinking. It would drive me crazy if that was me. But, you know, some people say that's a gift, but that would be a cross. Don't you think? If I knew what everybody was thinking in this room, that'd be horrible. It's like, oh, they didn't like that last joke. I better find another one. And like, how could you navigate that? You know, but those people that have that gift are dispassionate. They don't have any, there's the passions are no longer active in them. And so they're able to bear it, you know, and ultimately for people's good. But to be supremely aware of the other, it starts with this other first, right? The more aware I am of God in my life, the more aware I'm going to be of you. The more I am aware of God, what he's calling me to do, and I'm responding, the more I'm going to be sensitive to you and to your needs and to how I can be of service to you and ultimately live in a harmonious kind of, have a good relationship with you. You know, whether it's your spouse, whether it's your family, whether it's your friends, whatever it is. It's putting, I'm not first, but God is first. And if God is first, that means you're first. People come to me and they say, Father, he says, I couldn't put Christ first because my wife needs to be first. I said, if your wife is first, she's actually last and you're first. Why? Because ultimately what that means is I love me and I want you. Because the passions are as such and the fall is so great, we can't navigate it without the Lord. I'm sorry. And if you kick love out of the first place, which is God, how can I really say that you're in the first place and I'm loving you if I've actually taken love out of first place because God is love? Do you know what I'm saying? Without God, who is love, there's no love. How can I say that you're actually first? It doesn't compute. So your question, how do I avoid delusion? You can't give in to, number one, being motivated by selfishness and by your own desires. Ultimately, thy will be done, not mine, but thine. There has to be this sense of putting God first. And if God is first, everybody else can be oriented in a proper perspective in my life. Always taking counsel, and then not giving too much into emotionalism or into romanticizing my spiritual life. There's a tendency, especially in Catholicism today, to romanticize spirituality. Imagine you're at the cross. And you're there, and Jesus' mother is crying, and Mary Magdalene's there, and nobody else is there. Imagine what that's like. In Orthodoxy, you never, ever, ever use your imagination in prayer, period. Because it can become the medium through which demonic energy is transmitted to us. It can take on a life of its own, and it's called phantasm, where it becomes fantastic in the sense of it becomes this viscosity or medium through which the devil can kind of grab onto me. So we don't ever use imagination, and that will help to mitigate some of that nostalgic kind of movement in our heart, you know. It's okay to touch those moments where God has visited us, but we can't kind of squeeze the life out of them and ultimately try to stay there. You know, we have to move through those things. Lord Jesus Christ, the Son.